Hi, I'm John Doyle, the Artistic Director of Classic Stage Company, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to Classic Conversations. For some time now, we've been presenting this series of very informal chats shared between myself and an artist associated with our work. When we had to pause our rehearsal period for Assassins, I thought it would be important to continue the series online with members of that company. The conversation loosely follows the format of a British radio show called Desert Island Discs, where the celebrity castaway plays the music that they would listen to on their desert island. In this 30-minute virtual version, the castaway will share a couple of songs that feel important to them. Conversation sits at the heart of the enduring form that is the theatre, between writer and director, between director and actor, and most importantly, between the story and the audience. At this extraordinary crossroads in American life, honest conversation is more important than it has ever been. With that in mind, it's my privilege to welcome this week's castaway, Bianca Horn. Bianca, how are you?
I'm well. How are you, John?
I'm good. I miss you. It's too long now.
I know. It's almost 3 months since we were like in a rehearsal space together.
I know. I mean, I was saying to somebody today, you know, at least in one way, although that 3 months has seemed so long, so much has happened for bad and for good in those 3 months. And then I think, okay, well, Labor Day is 3 months away. So think how much more will have happened by Labor Day. You know, things will have got better, hopefully, by Labor Day. We'll know more. We'll know more about vaccines and all the different things that will help toward us coming back together again, really. But it's been extraordinary. So where are you?
So funny enough, it was Monday, I think like March 16th, you sent us an update about what we were going to be doing with rehearsal. That very week, my husband was supposed to come visit his family in Wisconsin. I'm one of those performers, I don't always know how to be a performer and a wife at the same time. So I was like, hey, darling, do you want to go visit your family so I can figure this acting thing? And then you can come back when I can like be a better wife and an artist all at the same time. And so he actually had plans to leave on Wednesday. And then we got your email saying that we're going to basically put everything on pause. And an hour later, we booked a flight for both of us to come that Monday night to Wisconsin. Wow. There were 25 people on the Southwest flight. And we've been here ever since.
Wow.
Yeah.
So I remember you sending a picture, I think, early on when you were there, and you were in snow, I think, at that point in time.
Oh, yes. So we were in upstate Wisconsin on Cranberry Lake is what it's called. And when we got there, we actually, as a family, walked the lake to this little deserted island, whereas last week, it's all water. People are on their boats. They're fishing. In the 2.5 months we've been there, we have literally seen winter and spring happen.
Wow.
Yeah.
I remember you referring in one moment in rehearsal, I was talking to everybody and I said something like, you know, how do you, I refer to myself as a British person. You know, I said, I want to ask you all as a UK person, how you as Americans feel about this story. That I think was my question. And I remember you saying, well, I wasn't born an American. I think that's what you said. I think those were the words you used. Am I right in saying?
You're right. Yeah.
So where do you come from originally?
Originally, I'm from Port-au-Prince, Haiti. Okay. My family came to the U.S. when I was about 6 years old. They moved to Miami. My mom actually, when she first came, lived in New York and decided the winters were too horrible for her with her Caribbean blood. So when she
wouldn't have liked Wisconsin then.
Oh no, she's visited here once during winter and she was like, never again. I'll come during the summer. I grew up in Miami once we left Haiti.
Right. And so do you, when you left Haiti, I mean, do you remember Haiti quite? You obviously still know it, but do you remember being a child there?
Yeah, actually, I have memories, and recently I visited again with my mother. And we still own the childhood home I had in Haiti. And it's funny how when you get back into the space, how you're flooded with memories again that you didn't even know you had. So, I mean, memories of playing or a nanny, friends around the neighborhood, like all those little memories did come back.
So do you think of yourself as Haitian or as American?
I think myself at this point as Haitian American. I've been here way too long to deny the American part of me. The cultural pride I have, I still speak Creole. We were made to speak the language at home. I cook the food, I speak the language. I love the culture. So I do feel like I am a good combination of both.
That's so interesting and so wonderful to be a good combination of both. It's interesting when people talk to me about being British, and I even have trouble saying that because I say, well, you know, I'm Scottish really, right? I mean, like, yeah, I kind of come from Britain, but of course it drives me crazy if somebody says, oh, that I'm English.
Yeah.
I just have to get off that boat straight away. I mean, I can't think like that because to me, that's like a totally different country. You know, I remember when I went to work in England, first of all, when I was, I was like 27 or something. And I really felt like I had emigrated.
I bet.
Yeah. And so when people say to me, how does it feel living in a foreign country? I think, well, being in America. And I think, well, I've already lived in a foreign country for a long time. You know, it's something to do with where you're born is so important, isn't it? I mean, crucial.
Agreed. I'd rather be called Haitian than Haitian American. There's a part of me that if I don't acknowledge that side, something about it doesn't feel honest.
I understand. And so then you went to school and theater school and all those things in Florida? No, you went to Texas too, didn't you?
So English, because it is my second language and I wasn't picking it up very quickly, I got put into oratory competitions starting in elementary school. My sister convinced my mom that I should be in theater programs just because it'll help me with my English. And I just fell in love with it. So I did like musical theater programs growing up in middle school and high school. And then I finally went to Southern Methodist University in Dallas, where I got my BFA in acting.
I mean, that's so interesting to me because you, to my ear, you have a very beautiful use of the English language, more than I'm sometimes used to hearing in America. I mean, you have a very precise, clear, but also very eloquent use of the English language. I thought about that, about you since we first met. So do you think that came from that oratory training?
Absolutely.
How interesting.
Yeah, I even minor in English. There's something about the construction of words.
I can tell that. That's
really exciting, yeah.
Yeah, how interesting. And then, so after school, did you come straight to New York?
I did. Funny enough, I graduated. I went home for a little bit, trying to figure out where I was going to do this thing called art. Growing up in Miami, Miami's not a big place to do it. It was either go to Orlando or go to New York, because I have actually my dad's side of the family. I have a lot of family in Brooklyn. So. Okay. An audition came up for Hairspray, the last leg of the non-union tour in 2009.
Okay.
And we tried driving to Orlando because they had auditions there, and our car broke down in the middle of like trying to get there. And finally, I was like, okay, I'll go to New York. I'll stay with my family there and audition. And because I got that show, I actually didn't come back to New York for another 7 months.
Right.
Yeah.
And you've kind of been around New York other than in touring ever since.
Correct.
Yeah. And so when you came to New York, were you perceived as, I mean, you would not have been perceived as a Haitian American actress. Yeah. You were received as perceived within the profession I'm talking about, which is what I'm interested in us talking about, really. You were perceived as an African American actress, presumably.
Absolutely.
And how did that feel, that you were being identified in a way that was not truly how you saw yourself?
It's interesting because growing up in Miami, the diversity that is present for all Caribbean islands. Growing up, everyone I knew was either Bahamian, Jamaican, Trinidadian. Yes. It wasn't a automatic assumption that you were a thing. You always had to ask, hey, where are you from? Where are your people from? Yeah. Whereas like once I left my bubble in Miami, people always thought I was just African American. So it's a taught thing you learn to accept. And when you have the opportunity to correct, then you can say, hey, I'm actually, my background is other. I am Black, but I'm actually Caribbean. I am Black, but I'm actually African. It doesn't always get asked, every once in a while, but not frequently.
And why is that, do you think? Is that people just not paying enough attention?
Correct. I think it's easier to just make the assumption and just put us in one box. Yes. You need, you just need a Black person.
Yes.
That the difference doesn't really matter. I mean, even in just saying that, I've been in shows that I've auditioned for and I'm too Black, or I'm not Black enough, or can you, I mean, actually been asked in the audition room, can you make that more ethnic? So within,
oh my God.
Oh yes. And it's a frequent, I mean, most actors I know that are Black, African-American, they have experienced some variation of that in an audition room.
And you know, all the way through all of our lives, we are all pigeonholed, I suppose, in order that people can decide how to relate to us. You know, I can see that those pigeonholes happen, you know. They happen in the UK, certainly. You know, we have pigeonholing images of the Irish or the Scots that is different from the English. Or you know, but do you find that that pigeonholing that happens in casting, if you like, in choices in the American theatre, is prohibitive? Is it a block to your development, that pigeonholing?
Absolutely. I remember in college doing work that I have yet been able to audition for as a professional actor. Shakespearean work, where color didn't matter. I mean, I was the only African-American female in my class, but there were other people in our program. And we got colorblind casting. I mean, you did Ibsen work and it didn't matter. You did Shakespearean work and it didn't matter. And to leave that educational bubble where you can be anything, and to go into the professional where you can only be one thing is quite frustrating. Because as an actor, you train to become any character, to mold yourself into anything. And yet you are only seen for a thing.
Yeah. It's deeply frustrating and must be, and deeply upsetting. I mean, I was struck last season, somebody that we've both worked with, in Jamie, who played, she played Lady Macduff in the Scottish play, you know, the play that we mentioned the title of. and she played Lady Macduff, so she was playing a sort of aristocratic lady, if you like, although it was not done in that way. And I actually had somebody complain to me because they felt that an African-American actor couldn't play that kind of role, shouldn't be playing that kind of role. And I thought, oh my God, that was 2019.
Exactly.
In New York City, to a relatively sophisticated audience, hello, right?
It's mind blowing.
It's mind blowing. And of course, symptomatic of where we are, but it's mind-blowing.
I mean, I two things. I did a production of Smokey Joe's Cafe, which, I mean, I think it's almost half and half, but maybe 60-40 with the color.
Yeah.
It was at a regional theater, and the director shared a letter with me that he got. One of the patrons said that they believe that there were too many Black people in that production. And I thought to myself, you would never say that about Annie. You would never say that about Dear Evan Hansen. You wouldn't.
Yeah.
It is a thing. You would never say that about Fiddler.
Never.
However, when it came to Smokey Joe's, somehow six Black people was just way too many. Like it blows my mind that we can still have that train of thought.
That's correct. That we're not moving on, or we're not moving on way fast enough. So tell me then, what's your first song that you're going to sing?
My first song. So growing up in Miami, I went to a wonderful high school called Miami Northwestern Senior High School. Go Bulls. and we had a teacher named Ms. Seward. And she, more so than any other teacher I had, really made sure I understood the history of African-American musical theater and plays and African-American playwrights, Caribbean playwrights. And she introduced the show Your Ain't Misbehavin' to us, which was, she played, she was a standby mm-hmm. when she tried to make it out in New York for the yeah. original Broadway production. Yeah. So it was a musical dear to her heart. She covered Miss Carter. And so the song You're Mean to Me is a song I've always loved. The story of it is just so beautiful. This woman is truly exposing her heart and telling her story to the person that she loves. And it was one of the first musicals that had people that looked like me in all shades. Yeah. And that meant so much. Yeah. Seeing them, seeing their photo on the album, it means that I could do it. It meant that yeah. I could do it. Which yes. was so exciting.
Very exciting. Well, here it is. Bianca, I obviously the thing that, apart from Assassins, which we're almost so early in the journey of that, you know, we'll be able to talk about that much more if I was to do another one of these after that event, which will happen. But the show I think that obviously connects us most is The Color Purple.
Yes.
And I've been thinking about The Color Purple a lot this week. It's been hard not to, you know. I feel very moved when I think about The Color Purple. I always have since I started working on it. And with the events that have been going on around us in America, it's made me think about it even more. And I was struck with, I went back to look at some of the lyrics, and I was looking at this lyric. It says, which is from the title song, and it says, it takes a grain of love to make a mighty tree. Even the smallest voice can make a harmony. It's so beautiful, isn't it?
So beautiful.
So beautiful. And so Alice Walker, you know, so much the beauty of that woman's soul shining through. How did you feel? You did that a whole year on tour, didn't you? Was that a year?
Yeah. Almost. Yeah.
And you went all over America. And talk to me about it. We've never really talked about what that tour felt like. I'm sure you've said to me, oh, we had a great time or whatever, but we've never talked about the underbelly of that and the business of taking that kind of story, not to Broadway, right, but to communities that as a generalization, maybe needed to hear that story even more, you know? Yeah. Share with me some of your thoughts about The Color Purple.
Well, the very first memory I have it is the first day of rehearsal, when you walked in and you said to us, I am not blinded by the fact that I am a white man trying to help tell a Black community story. The moment you said that, I think you had everyone in the room in your hand. You said, I understand humanity, and this is a story about people, and that's what we're going to honor. And that's what we did for a year. The truth is, in our current state as a country, there were some cities it was scary to perform in. You didn't feel comfortable. You didn't know if you were going to be okay, because of some of the hateful things you read, you hear, you see. You think, well, we are all Black cast. This is a perfect opportunity for someone who wants to do something ugly to do it. And somehow in the year that we were out there, we were totally covered by grace and nothing ever happened. And I learned to trust humanity more. People would come up to us, John, after the performance and said, I remember it was in South Carolina specifically. A woman said, I come here for all the shows. And I never get to speak to the people to my right, to the people to my left. I'm always watching by myself. And she said, at the end of The Color Purple, the white person next to her touched her hand as they watched that final moment. She said, this was a first theater experience. I felt as if we were in it together.
Yeah.
And that is the beauty of the book, of the musical. Yeah. It is a story about the humanity of these people. They happen to be Black.
That's right. But
that's what I love about it. It is one of the few stories that Black people can tell that you feel like you're just telling a story. It didn't matter what color you were, because everyone can actually see the story. They can see the heart. They understand pain. They understand being abandoned. They understand strength, finding yourself, losing yourself. Yeah. It's a story that everyone can relate to. Yeah. And it was powerful.
Yeah. I mean, there's no doubt, you know, I'm often quoted for saying this, but I've always believed that theater is the thing that makes us the same, that shows us our sameness. You know, that here I am as an elderly white man talking to you, a beautiful young Black woman, and we are the same, do you know?
Yes.
And that's, we have the same fear. I mean, I think these last few months have expressed the fact that we all share the same fear, not just the events
from last
weeks. And the commonality of that fear or love or joy in theater is such a fascinating thing.
Yeah.
And that gives you hope, I think, really. Now, but as a Black woman, it felt right to be in The Color Purple, yes? You weren't asked to be Black.
No, it felt you were asked to just be.
Yeah.
I wasn't asked to be more Black, less Black. I was asked to play a woman that understood joy, pain, laughter. And it was freeing.
Yeah. It's interesting, all those words we use too, isn't it? Like, be more something. You know, what does that ever mean? Is that what people say? A friend of ours, she once said to me that she'd been asked to, she was auditioning, and whoever was auditioning said to her, now do it again, but sell it. And I said, and she said, I didn't know what to do. And I said, well, sell what? What are you selling? it's such generality, isn't it, as opposed to stopping and thinking, how do I get at the quietest moments of this person? How do I reflect what humanity really is?
Yeah.
And it feels to me that, you know, I mean, how do you feel going back to New York City, right? Which I think you're doing quite soon.
Yes, we leave in about 2 weeks to head home again.
And you think of it as home, which is beautiful. Yeah. How do you feel about going back to the city now?
I mean, honestly, everything just seems really uncertain.
Yeah.
As far as our career, theater isn't safe, but we still need arts.
Yeah.
So how do we navigate through that during a time when we probably need it the most?
Yeah.
We have a current political state that doesn't feel safe.
Yeah.
People of black and brown skin feel scared and worried going back home. That too is a concern.
Yeah.
But I don't feel like this is the first time our society has ever dealt with this, with storms, with viruses, with diseases. Like, it has happened in history. And if those people can be resilient, I think we can be as well. President Obama actually wrote an article about how this is the turning point. And I think for many, including myself, it's making me realize, when I go home, what can I do to not be idle, to not just be worried about the pandemic and where it's ending, but how can I use my intelligence, my voice, my power to help support my local community, to create art within the space I am able to create it in. So as daunting and as unknowing as the future is, I always have hope. I'm a person of faith, I'm a believer, and I'm always gonna side on the side of hope more than the side of fear, because that always leads me into my purpose. And I'm leaning in towards that.
I think that's the only way to be. I'm, as you know, I'm sure I've referred to it, I'm also a person of faith, and I believe we have a sort of terrible phrase in Scotland in a way, but my granny used to say, what's for you won't go by you. What's for you won't pass you by. You will have to face what's for you, but you do it with hope. And
exactly.
And I agree with you about, you know, the theatre is, of course, it, I would say, wouldn't I, that it's needed now more than ever. It is. I've no doubt about it. And I think what we have to do as artists is just to make sure that our voices aren't taken away, that we do everything we can to make our voices heard, not necessarily by yelling and shouting, but by being and by using language and by using the things that we're given to tell our story and reflect our common stories, our communal stories on the world. It seems more important than it could ever otherwise have been, I think. You know, I was struck too, I think I may have told you before, but I went to the University of Georgia in Athens, Georgia in the 70s. I went there in 1973, which was 5 years after 68, when Bobby Kennedy and Martin Luther King Jr. were both assassinated. And I remember, I so clearly remember, as a high school student, first of all, remember that year of 68 when all those things happened. It's as clear to me as could be. I can remember young kids of my age, 16-year-olds, whatever we were, crying together in the school hallway because those things were going on. And that was in Inverness in Scotland, right? That was a long way from Georgia.
Yeah.
And I got to Georgia, and you could feel, even then, 5 years later, you could still feel it, right? Of course you could. Of course you could. And we still feel it now, right?
Yeah.
You know, we've learned and yet we've not learned. And we have to keep opening our eyes to learning, to change. I think that's the crucial thing. So what's
and to have the tough conversations. I'm in a biracial relationship, and Sunday evening, because I am here and my husband's, my in-laws, we had a tough conversation as a family just about race, about the things we actually don't talk about.
Yeah.
About what other people deal with, about privilege and what that looks like, about not being privileged and what that looks like. Yeah. And we need to keep having those conversations.
My God, we do. My God, we do. We are lucky, I think, often that we get to have some of them in rehearsal rooms.
Oh, yeah.
Not always deep enough, but we get to open them up at least. But you're right, everybody needs to. And somehow have those conversations without taking a political side, or, you know, but actually just as humans have those conversations.
Yeah, yeah.
So what's your second song?
The second song is from one of my favorite musicals, The Color Purple. I love this song. The lyric says, God is inside you and everyone else. The song is sung to Celie when she's at her lowest moment, when she has lost faith, hope in the one thing she has believed in her whole life, which is God. And Shug comes in to remind her of who she is, remind her of what she actually possesses inside of her. And not to box up what you think God is, that God is in everything, that God is in you. You have that power. I love the song. I sing it to myself sometimes during this pandemic when I feel low.
I love it too. I love it too. And of course, she's singing it to her at Easter, at that time of resurrection.
Yeah, exactly.
At the darkest moment and the brightest moment all in the same time. Here it is.
No, Celie. God not a man like the pictures you've seen of him. God not a man at all. God is inside you and everyone else. That was or ever will be. We come into this world with God, but only them who look inside find it. God is the flowers and everything else that was or ever truth so real, and when you love the way you feel, you found it. Just as sure as moonlight bless the night, like a blade of corn, like a like a waterfall, all a part of me, like the color purple. Where do it come from? Open up your eyes. Look what God has done.
The Color Purple. Gosh, I mean, you know, the end of The Color Purple, Bianca, when that song is reprised with the whole company, and some nights the whole audience is something else again, isn't it? It's something else again.
It took me 3 months to not cry every night when we sang that song.
Oh, yeah.
The beauty of it. Beauty of it.
I mean, you know, when you're directing a musical that goes on for a long time, you know, I don't mean that one evening. Years, I you know, you get tired of bits and the bits you can't watch anymore, and you've seen so many people do them, and blah, 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 blah. And yet I never ever got tired of going in and watching the end of that show. I never did. When Celie meets Nettie again after all that time, it's one of the most beautiful, and that leading into that whole community rising together as one voice. It's extraordinary. So listen, the first question is, if you were going to your imaginary desert island.
Okay.
And you're allowed one luxury.
Uh-huh.
What would it be that you're allowed to take with you, one luxury?
I think it would be an endless supply of tennis shoes.
Tennis shoes?
Yes.
Why?
In the last 5 years, I don't know what's wrong. I have developed a love for running. If you told me when I was a teenager I would be running, I'd laugh at you. I tell you, you were lying. I was not the most athletic person. I'm actually supposed to run the New York City Marathon this year.
Wow. Wow.
I'm supposed to start training in 2 weeks, and I've decided whether or not it happens, I'm doing it.
Good for you. But
there's a freedom that I have discovered in running. It makes me feel like I'm in charge. I own my body. I own my space. And if I'm on that desert island, I'm going to be doing circles around it. So I'm going to need tennis shoes to do that.
Good for you. Good for you. And of course, you certainly know about an island, not a desert island, but you know about a beautiful island. So
I do.
That's kind of wonderful. And then you're given two books to take. You're given the Bible, and you're given the complete works of Shakespeare. But you are allowed a third book. What do you think it would be?
Oh, that's a tough one. I love books, John. That's a tough one. Oh, a third book. The autobiography of my mother by Jamaica Kincaid. I've read it maybe 5-6 times.
Wow.
I love autobiographies.
Me too.
It is a powerful one. She is such a brilliant writer. It is one of my favorites. So I think I would have to take that with me.
Very good. Very, very good. And you're allowed, before I ask you the final question, you're allowed to ask me a question. What would you like to ask me?
Oh, John. When did you know you wanted to be a director? What was it?
It was a long I don't know that I ever really knew that I wanted to be a director. I was an only child. I helped all my cousins. There were many of them, 17 of them, all younger than me. I helped them all to read, not all, but many of them, taught some of them to read, helped them to play. I was the babysitter to all of them. And I was the child of parents who weren't particularly, it wasn't always the happiest household, let's put it that way. And so I was a kind of mediator. I was the peacemaker. I was the one who kept it all okay. So I think those are some of the things that made me a director, right?
Mm-hmm.
I suppose when I started, I really thought I would be an actor, probably. Although that didn't stay with me for very long. I know why I like to be a director. I don't think it's to do with control. I think it's to do with the desire to learn from the story and get to the heart of the story. And I was given an opportunity. Somebody asked me if I would like to direct a play in a season where I was a young actor, and I of course said yes, and that was it really. And I followed that ever since. I've always done it. I had certain targets that I wanted for myself. You know, I come from a background of no theatre, there was good education, but, you know, I don't come from any kind of intellectual background or anything like that. So I always had to work quite hard. I wasn't a particularly good student. In fact, I think I was quite a bad student until I found something that I loved. And I realized that the love of the theatre didn't matter to me which way I went in the theatre. It was more about being in the theatre, being part of this art form that so many times I've thought in my life, what's this for? What's it all about? Why didn't I become a minister? Why didn't I become a social worker? Why am I not doing something useful? And then I've stopped and looked at it again and again, and I thought, actually, it is useful. Just shut up and get on with it and deal with all the hard bits. I do know, though, that I do remember being in the rehearsal room for the first time as a director. It was actually not a professional show. I was directing a play in my local community, and I remember the feeling of being in that rehearsal room and the extraordinary joy of that experience of being in a room of a group of people trying to figure it out. So I suppose at that moment I really knew that I wanted to be a director. I still feel like that. I find the rehearsal room harder to go into nowadays because I'm older and I know what the mistakes are, do you know?
Yeah.
So yeah. That scares me more. But boy, do I love rehearsing a good piece of theater. Don't you?
I love creating a new piece.
Oh my God. Yeah. Oh my God. And you know, the piece that we're working on, to work on a piece like Assassins that has got such real depth, you know, it's really got something to say about, oh my God, you know, about those who do not have the privileges that we have, those who are not listened to, those who are put to the bottom of whatever the heap is, and have no other way to express their voice other than through a violent action. Could there possibly be a more pertinent time to do Assassins when we come back to doing it? No.
No. We thought it was important before, but it feels even more relevant now.
Oh my goodness, yes. So, and finally, if you were only allowed to take one of those two songs to your desert island, what would it be?
Color Purple.
Sure.
I'm positive.
Yeah, it has to be.
It has to be.
Bianca, thank you so much for spending time with me. And I'm going to, on behalf of us both, say goodbye to everybody. But I'm going to say to you, I hope I see you soon.
Me too.
And if nothing else, when you're back in New York and I'm next in New York, we'll put our masks on and we'll walk 6 feet apart through a Central Park or something lovely like that, because nothing would make me happier. I'm going to say goodbye to the viewers, if you like. Who I hope have enjoyed us and who I hope can take some little bit of our conversation forward into their week. And I'm going to finish with some words from The Color Purple. Rising like the sun is the hope that sets us free. Your heartbeat makes my heart beat when we share love.